Our first scripture reading is from the second book of Kings, chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. Kings, chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. Now, when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a wild wind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went to Bethel. They went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Elijah said to him, "Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know. Be silent." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them. As the boat was standing by Jordan, then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I'm taken from you." Elisha said, "Please let me inherit a double share of your spirit." He responded, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet, if you see me as I am being taken away from you, it will be granted to you. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them. And Elijah ascended in the wild wind into heaven. Elisha kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariot of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own cloth and tore them into pieces. This is the word of the Lord. Please remain seated and let us see holiness, the words are in the pre-written in the insert.
So before I read our gospel reading this morning, I just wanted to remind all of the little ones that there are some coloring sheets and word searches in the back if you would like to do those during the sermon. So our gospel reading this morning. Our gospel reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 9, verses 2 through 9. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James. Overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice. "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So this morning is Transfiguration Sunday. The two texts this morning lift up instances of times when people were transfigured or perceptions were transformed. In the Mark passage, just like at Jesus' baptism, we hear God's voice come down from the heavens, declaring that Jesus is God's Son. This revelation to the disciples, showing Jesus to truly be the Messiah, happens on a mountaintop. Likewise, the Old Testament passage recalls Elijah's encounter with God, and that also takes place on a mountaintop. If you think back on different Bible passages, lots of things happen to take place up in the mountains. It's where God reveals the Ten Commandments to Moses. Jesus delivers the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus is tempted on a mountain. Because mountains are especially significant in the Bible, in part because it was thought that they allowed us to physically be closer to God. However, today is not only Transfiguration Sunday. In the Presbyterian Church, it's also National Camp and Conference Sunday. It's the one Sunday in our calendar where the National Church tells us and encourages churches to focus on summer camp. This seems like a silly thought in February when there's snow everywhere. But actually, it's a great time to start thinking about and talking about camp. I read lots of posts online this week about pastors struggling to connect Transfiguration Sunday and Camp Sunday. But to me, it makes total sense. See, I have a very long history with summer camps. I'm the youngest of three children, and every summer we were shipped off to camp. In fact, when I was 5 years old, my mother lied about my age so that I could go to camp for the whole summer. It was so I could go with my older brother, but then he ignored me all summer long. So summer camps have been a huge part of my life for 24 years. When I was 7, I started attending the Presbyterian Church in South Boston and convinced my parents to stop sending me to camp with my brother and to instead send me to Camp Wilmot, the Presbyterian camp in New Hampshire. And it was that summer that I discovered why people love summer camp. I love Camp Wilmot. It's my home away from home. So when the National Church is telling us that we should be talking about camp today, I jumped at the opportunity. Like I said, I started going to Camp Wilmot when I was 7 years old. When I was 14, I became a counselor in training. At 16, I was a counselor and had my own cabin full of little girls and was staying for the entire summer. When I was in college, I became a director and started directing our off-season retreats. And now I'm the chair of the board of directors. That means that any decision that needs to be made about the camp, either I have to decide or I have to sign off on it. It means I help make sure everything is in place for our youth camps during the summer. It means I spread the message about camp and what an awesome place it is to the neighboring churches and presbyteries. No pressure. But I love it because Camp Wilmot isn't one of those summer camps that looks like a resort. It isn't a ritzy summer camp with horseback riding or air conditioning in the cabins. So why do I love it so much? I think it's because it's real. It doesn't have to be ritzy to be a great summer experience. While we don't have horseback riding, we have archery and soccer, arts and crafts and canoeing and kayaking. And next month we're installing brand new docks so that all of our campers can swim together. And while there isn't air conditioning or Wi-Fi in the cabins, there's camaraderie and friendships being formed. There's cabin Bible study growth as Christians and as people. So for me, on a personal level, camp is all about transfiguration. As a counselor, I've watched so many kids transform from being six-year-old campers to being counselors themselves. And I've watched as homesick kids who were afraid to engage on the first day not want to leave at the end of camp and are already planning for the following summer. And I have personally been transfigured. I knew nothing about God when I started going to camp. I was raised in a Catholic family that really only went to church for weddings and funerals. And it was through Bible studies in our cabin or Vesper services, which are when a cabin gets to plan the worship service for the night, that I began to learn about Jesus and about the Bible. Now, I was a pretty awkward kid. I didn't really have too many friends growing up, except for at camp. At camp, I developed a family, and I'm still friends with many of the people that I met my first summer at camp. It helped me gain confidence. It helped me learn how to share my thoughts on the Bible, different things we were learning, and pretty much anything else. And I'm not afraid to share my opinions now. So, unlike in the Mark passage, I've never truly heard the word of God, or rather the voice of God. There's never been a bright shining light and a voice from on high telling me God's plan for me, or saying, you know, this is my daughter in whom I'm well pleased. Instead, in my life, God has mainly talked through other people. People have told me that they thought I would be good at something, that I should give something particular, like being a pastor, a try. It was at camp that I first felt God calling in my life, a calling to lead people, a calling to teach people, and more than anything, a calling to help people. So I think I've definitely been transfigured and transformed by camp. Unlike Jesus, I haven't been clothed in brilliant white that no leash could touch, but rather I've been clothed in Camp Lamont t-shirts and sweatshirts. There hasn't been that brilliant light that they talk about in the Bible, unless you count the summer sun that likes to give me burns as a reminder of its power. At camp, we have a big hill called Vesper Hill. At the top of the hill is a very large wooden cross where we occasionally have our nightly worship services. Like many throughout the Bible, I've often felt closest to God when on this hill. Perhaps because, like the mountaintops of the Bible, it's because I'm physically closer to the sky and therefore closer to where we have traditionally believed God is. There were times in college where I would get in my car and drive from Clinton to Camp Lamont, which is about a 2.5-hour drive, just to sit on top of this hill, to be in the wilderness, to be closer to God, and to think. This mountain helped me make huge decisions in my life. It was on top of this mountain that I felt God nudging me toward seminary, nudging me to find a way to be a leader in the church and to help God's people. So I'm here this morning to share my love of camp, to preach about transfiguration and the National Camp Sunday. But why am I at Clinton? If you've been around long enough, you might know that I actually met the Dickinsons at camp. We were all volunteering during a week of camp, and through them I became involved and a member at this church. And since that time, this church has grown a lot. We have so many families right now, and that means, because we have so many new families, it means we have so many kids. Back in the day, back when I was a kid, this church sent kids to camp. In fact, one of my best camp friends was sent by this church. For those that have been here forever, it'd be the Corellis family. So, quite a long time. But still, one of my best friends, and it was through camp that we met. Jen found a bulletin from the 1960s talking about the church sending a group of kids to Camp Lamont for youth camp. And we would like to bring that back. Last year, year, one kid from Clinton Presbyterian Church went to Camp Lamont. And that is awesome.
Yeah.
And a little bit later, Brandon is going to share a little bit about his experience. My goal is to get even more kids from this church family to have the experience of going to Camp Lamont for a week, to see this amazing and transformative place. But camp is expensive. It costs $400 for a week at camp. And just like it takes a village to raise a child, it also takes a village to send a kid to camp. When I was a kid, we did different fundraisers to raise money so that we could go to camp. Some worked really well, like ice cream fundraisers after church or selling Krispy Kreme donuts. Others were kind of awful. They were the ones the kids didn't want to do, the adults didn't want to sign up to help with. Things like a rock-a-thon, where people sponsored us to sit and rock in a rocking chair for 24 hours straight. 8-year-olds, 10-year-olds sitting in a rocking chair for 24 hours. It was awful for everyone.
Note to self, no rock-a-thon, okay.
I want to help us raise money to send kids from this church that want to go to camp. So downstairs, there's a sheet of paper on one of the tables that just has some fundraisers that I found that have worked for other churches. And because I want the kids of this church to have the chance to go to camp, I've actually worked out a deal with the camp board. So if we're able to send 3 or more kids to camp, for every kid that we send, they'll get a discount. So it will be less than what we charge kids at other churches. So it's cold out right now, and there's snow everywhere, and we aren't really thinking about our summer plans yet. We're trying to get through the rest of winter. But it's the perfect time to start thinking about summer camp and start figuring out how this village can send kids to be transformed, can send kids to grow as Christians and as people, to be on a mountain closer to God and experience their own transformation and transfiguration, whatever that might look like for each of them. On Transfiguration Sunday, we share the way that Jesus was revealed to us as the Messiah. As we also celebrate Camp Sunday, it is my hope to reveal to our church kids a new and amazing way to encounter our Messiah. Amen. Like I said, Brandon was the one kid from Clinton last summer that went to Camp Belmont.
Forward learning is
like you wake up early in the morning. We have a league. So you wake up early in the morning and like you go jump in the lake. And like you would see a man dressed in a polar bear suit dancing on the other side. So
that was a real polar bear.
Was it?
If it was a real polar bear, I would probably call animal control. So that was pretty funny. And after, we would do like, after that we would brush our teeth and then go to the dining hall to eat breakfast.
So note to self, parents, brushing teeth is encouraged for the campers.
Sometimes I try to get away from taking a shower but it didn't work. I don't want to take showers because the bathroom looked dirty. Every time I looked in a corner, there would be a spider.
Because it's a cabin,
and
spiders like it.
Yeah. At first, I was just about to go to sleep. By the second day, we went to go, after breakfast, we went to go somewhere to do activities for the day. No, yeah. The first day, we actually got to race on s'mores. So that was fun. We got to get to know each other better. So one of my cabinets and I were sticking, we were putting sticks in the fire. Someone took our sticks away and they were just breathing the fire.
Safety is important too. Things like fire,
okay. Anything that improves fire, making an effect. After that, we went back to our cabins.
church. And Jen and I have been going through old things in anticipation of the celebrations that we're going to have this year. And this is the bulletin from 1965, May 30th. Here's the note. Church hopes to have youth, those entering grades 5 and older, attend Camp Wilmot this summer. Aww. More information on the bulletin boards. So this is not just a random thing that we're doing, but this is really part of our church history and heritage, and that's pretty cool. So for our offering today, we're going to start off with a chance for you to give to a special offering that will start the scholarship fund for Camp Wilmot. Okay, and then we'll have the usher to pass the plate as usual. I think, you know, we hear a lot about the importance of investing in our children. And at a time when we see schools start losing funding, or parents are strapped to put their kids in after-school and daycare programs, contributing together as a community to invest in our kids this way is kind of an awesome and important thing that we have the power to do. So I'm excited to throw my check in. If anyone has questions, let's let them talk to you during coffee hour.